Hello and welcome to this beginner-friendly tutorial on cat versus dog image classification. In this video, we'll explore how to build a machine learning model that can differentiate between cat and dog images. We're going to walk through every step together using Python, Jupyter Notebook, and TensorFlow/Keras. By the end of this session, you'll know how to set up your dataset, pre-process your images, create and train a convolutional neural network, and even save your model for future use. Let's dive right in. Before we jump into coding, let's ensure your environment is set up correctly. You'll need Python 3 installed, and you'll also need Jupyter Notebook, which you can get either through Anaconda or by installing it via pip. Make sure you're running TensorFlow version 2 or higher. It's also helpful to be comfortable navigating folders, as we'll organize our cat and dog images into specific directories. Once your setup is complete, open a Jupyter Notebook and we can start coding. Let's organize our dataset. First, create a main folder named Data. Inside that, create two subfolders, Train and Validation. In the Train folder, create two more subfolders, one for cats and one for dogs, and place the corresponding images into each folder. Then replicate this structure in the Validation folder with your validation images. This setup is important because Keras's image data generator will automatically assign labels to the images based on these folder names. Let's kick off our notebook by importing all the necessary libraries and checking our TensorFlow version to ensure everything is set up correctly. We start by importing OS, NumPy, and matplotlib.pyplot. The OS module helps us manage file paths, NumPy takes care of numerical operations, and matplotlib.pyplot lets us plot graphs like accuracy and loss. Next, we import TensorFlow as TF, which is our main deep learning library. We also bring in Keras from TensorFlow, a high-level API that simplifies building neural networks, and its Layers module, which gives us access to layers such as Conv2D, MaxPool2D, and Dense. Additionally, we import the image data generator from TensorFlow.Keras.Preprocessing. Image. This tool is perfect for reading images from our folders and even performing data augmentation. Finally, we print out the TensorFlow version to make sure you're running TensorFlow version 2 or higher. Now, go ahead and run this cell in your Jupyter Notebook. If the cell executes without any errors, it means all the required libraries have been imported correctly. Since the cell already prints the TensorFlow version, seeing that output confirms the cell ran successfully. Also, keep an eye on the cell's indicator on the left. While the cell is running, you'll see an asterisk. And once it completes, the asterisk will be replaced by a number. Take your time to verify there are no errors, and then we'll move on to the next step. Next, we set up our folder paths for the training and validation data, and define some key hyperparameters that affect how our model processes images. We start by defining a base directory called data. From there, we create the training and validation paths by joining this base directory with train and validation. We then set our batch size to 32, which means our model will process 32 images at a time during training. All images will be resized to 150 by 150 pixels, ensuring consistency, and we plan to run through the entire training data 10 times, which we call 10 epochs. Go ahead and run this cell to ensure that all the variables are defined correctly. You won't see any output unless there's an error. So if everything runs smoothly, you're ready to move on to the next step. Next, we prepare our images before training. Preprocessing scales our images so that pixel values are between 0 and 1, and augmentation applies random transformations like rotations and flips, making the model more robust. We begin by setting up a data generator for the training images using Image Data Generator. Here, rescale normalizes the pixel values. We also add parameters such as rotation range to rotate images up to 20 degrees, width shift range, and height shift range to shift images slightly in either direction, zoom range to zoom in up to 20%, and horizontal flip to randomly flip images horizontally. The fill mode parameter makes sure any gaps from these transformations are filled in smoothly. For the validation data, we only rescale the images as we generally don't want to augment validation data. Then, by calling .flow from directory, we point to our directory containing subfolders for each class, set a target size to resize all images to the same dimensions, define our batch size, and specify binary as our class mode since we are dealing with two classes, cats and dogs. When you run this cell, you should see output messages like found 8,005 images belonging to two classes for training, and found 2,023 images belonging to two classes for validation. These messages confirm that your data is being loaded correctly and is properly organized into the two classes. If you see these outputs, everything is working as expected. Now, let's move on to the next step. Now, let's build our convolutional neural network. We'll use Keras' sequential model to stack layers linearly. We start with a Conv2D layer that applies 32 filters, each of size 3x3, to our input images. This layer uses the ReLU activation function to introduce non-linearity, and it expects our input images to be 150x150 pixels with three color channels, RGB, next. We add a max pooling 2D layer that reduces the spatial dimensions by taking the maximum value in each 2x2 window, which cuts down on computation. We can then add more convolutional and pooling layers to capture increasingly complex features in the images. Once we've extracted the features, we use the flatten layer to convert the 2D feature maps into a 1D vector. This vector is then fed into a dense layer with 128 neurons and ReLU activation to learn from the data. To prevent overfitting, we include a dropout layer that randomly sets 50% of the inputs to zero during training. Finally, our model concludes with a dense layer containing a single neuron with a sigmoid activation function, which outputs a probability between 0 and 1, making it ideal for our binary classification task of distinguishing between cats and dogs. Go ahead and run this cell to create your model. If no errors appear, it means your model architecture has been built successfully. After constructing our CNN layers, we need to compile the model. Compiling tells our model how to learn by specifying the loss function, optimizer, and the metric we care about. Here, we use binary cross entropy as the loss function because we're dealing with a two-class problem, cats versus dogs. We choose the atom optimizer, which adjusts the learning rate as training progresses, and we track accuracy to monitor our model's performance. Lastly, calling model.summary prints a detailed overview of each layer, including the output shapes and parameter counts, so we can verify our setup. When you run this cell, you should see a concise table summarizing your model. This confirms that everything is set up correctly. If the code runs without error and displays the model summary, you're ready to move on. Now it's time to train our model. We use model.fit, which automatically fetches batches of images from our train generator. We've set the number of epochs to 10, meaning the model will see the entire training set 10 times. By specifying val generator as our validation data, the model evaluates its performance on the validation images after each epoch. When you run this cell, you will see outputs similar to this. Each epoch will display the training accuracy and loss, as well as the validation accuracy and loss. If the code runs without errors and these statistics are displayed, it means your model is training correctly. Great job! Let's move on to the next step after training. After training is complete, we can evaluate how well our model performed by visualizing the accuracy and loss curves for both training and validation sets. This visualization helps us detect issues such as overfitting or underfitting. We do this by accessing history. history, which stores the accuracy and loss values for each epoch. Then, using plti.subplot, we set up multiple plots in one figure, one for accuracy and another for loss. We plot the training accuracy with plt.plot using the epochs range, and similarly plot the validation accuracy. Finally, we add a legend to clearly distinguish between the training and validation curves. When you run this cell, you will see two separate plots, one for accuracy and one for loss. The accuracy plot shows how performance changes over the epochs for both the training and validation sets, while the loss plot tracks the decrease in error. Ideally, the accuracy should increase and the loss should decrease over time. If you notice that the validation curves are diverging significantly from the training curves, it might be a sign of overfitting or underfitting. Once you've taken a look at these charts, you can move on to testing the model on new images or tweaking your network as needed. Now it's time to test our model on some validation images to see how well it performs. First, we retrieve the class labels, for example, cats, dogs, from our training generator. Next, we obtain a batch of images and labels from the validation set. We then pick a random image from this batch and use model predict to get a prediction. By adding a new axis to our image, we ensure it matches the expected shape of 1, height, width, channels. If the predicted value is greater than 0.5, we classify it as a dog. Otherwise, it's a cat. Finally, we display the image with a title that shows both the predicted and true labels. The title appears in green if the prediction is correct, or red if it's incorrect. When you run this cell, it will randomly select a few images from the validation set, predict whether each is a cat or a dog, and display the results. The title for each image will appear in green if the prediction is correct, or red if it's incorrect. This gives you a quick visual check of your model's performance on unseen data. Lastly, we save our trained model to a file called catdogclassifier.h5. This file contains everything needed to recreate our model later: the architecture, weights, and even the optimizer state. When you want to use the model again for predictions, you can easily reload it using keras.models load model cat dog classifier to h5, right? When you run this cell, your trained model will be saved to a file named catdogclassifier.h5. This file includes everything you need to reload the model later for making predictions or further training. Congratulations! You've just built and trained a convolutional neural network that classifies cats and dogs. As a beginner, you've covered all the essential steps: setting up your dataset, pre-processing images, defining your CNN architecture, training and validating your model, evaluating its performance, and finally, saving your model. If you're looking to boost accuracy even further, consider adding more layers, extending your training over more epochs, or using transfer learning with a pre-trained model like VGG16 or MobileNet. Thank you for following along. If you found this tutorial helpful, please like and subscribe for more machine learning tutorials. See you in the next one.